Also ich dann?
Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin Nabiyil Ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin Nabiyil Ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin Nabiyil Ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin Nabiyil Ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammadin Nabiyil Ummi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik alihi wa ala alihi. Are you rolling? Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. This is the third in our lectures, insha'Allah, on the kitab Afat al-Lisan from Imam al-Ghazali's Ihya Ulum al-Din. The title of the book is The Book of the Defects of the Tongue. And as we've seen, the Imam divides it into 20 defects, of which we have so far covered six. So just to remind you of what they are. Number one, irrelevant speech, al-kalam fima la ya'anik. Number two is excessive speech, fudul al-kalam. Number three, inappropriate speech, al-khawdu fil batil. Number four, disputatiousness, al-mira'u wal-jadal. Number five, debating, argumentation, khusuma, for the sake of a specific worldly end, wealth or fame. And the last one we looked at this morning was at-tashadduq bil-kalam, or at-taqa'ur, that is to say, elaborate, fancy use of language for no good end. So we're now going to move on, insha'Allah, to al-afatu al-sabi'a, the seventh defect, al-fuhshu wa-sabbu wa-bida'atu al-lisan, which really means al-fuhsh, vulgarity. That might be a slightly old-fashioned but accurate way of saying it. And it includes, of course, forms of obscenity. Sabbu is insulting, insults. That's another form of speech, which is, the Imam tells us, reprehensible. Wabida'atu lisan, it means kind of crude use of speech, foul language. Wahuwa madhmumun wa manhiyun an. It is reprehensible and forbidden. وَمَصْدَرُهُ الْخُبْثُ وَاللُّؤْمُ. And its source is a personal inner dirtiness and baseness of character. It is the base person, the low person, the person with a dirty mind who uses obscenities and who insults and curses others. قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمُ إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْفُحْشُ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى لَا يُحِبُّ الْفُحْشَ وَلَا التَّفَحُشُ. It's a hadith in the Mustadrak of Imam al-Hakim. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, this is an important collection of hadith, and there's a lot of al-Hakim's hadiths in the Ihya Ulum al-Din coming from the same Shafi'i, Ash'ari, Central Asian tradition. Imam Ghazali is in that, as it were, stream of hadiths. Hakim an-Nisapuri simply put together a large collection of hadiths, which includes hadiths which are sound according to the rules for hadith verification applied by Bukhari and Muslim, but which didn't make their way into their collections. So it's called Al-Mustadrak. That's the name of the book. So this is from the Mustadrak, and the Holy Prophet is saying here, in a sound hadith, beware of obscenity, because Allah, exalted is He, does not love obscenity or obscene behavior. And another hadith, also sound, وَنَهَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ عَنْ أَنْ تُسَبَّ قَتْلَ بَدْرٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. This is worth attending to. The Holy Prophet ﷺ forbade that those who had been killed of the idolaters at Badr should be insulted. فَقَالَ لَا تَسُبُّوا هَؤُلَاءَ فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَخْلُصُ إِلَيْهِمْ شَيْءٌ مِمَّا تَقُولُونَ وَتُؤْذُونَ الْأَحْيَاءَ أَلَا إِنَّ الْبِدَاءَ اللُّؤْمُ. So he's forbidden that the dead idolaters at Badr should be insulted, and he says, do not insult those people, because nothing of what you say will reach them, and you will only cause annoyance or distress to the living. Allah innal bidaa lu'm. Rough speech is a sign of baseness. And that's interesting, and in his context it was pretty revolutionary, because one of the things that one would do in the honor code of the ancient Arabs was to insult, or even to compose qasa'id poems in order to insult or to demean those whom you just defeated. It's a kind of boasting over a defeated enemy. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling his victorious army, don't insult the slain on the opposing side. وَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Now a hadith from Imam al-Tirmidhi, لَيْسَ الْمُؤْمِنُ بِالطَّعَانِ وَلَا اللَّعَانِ وَلَا الْفَاحِشِ وَلَا الْبَذِيِّ. The believer is not an insulter or a cursor or a rude person or an obscene person. He's not ta'an, that's to be constantly insulting, sort of impugning the honor of others. And he's not la'an, it's an emphatic form. He's not constantly cursing others. And neither is he al-fahish, somebody who uses sort of rude, vulgar language in his speech. Wal al-badhi, somebody who uses sort of obscenity, unrestrained speech. And this is all to do with the model of the believer as a person of muruwa, and a person of adab, a person of human dignity and restraint, and a person of adab or courtesy. So obscenity, cursing, using foul language is the sign of an unrefined individual. وَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ الْجَنَّةُ حَرَامٌ عَلَى كُلِّ فَاحِشٍ أَنْ يَدْخُلَهَا. Paradise is forbidden to every obscene person. وَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. That's another hadith from Tirmidhi. الْبِذَاءُ وَالْبَيَانُ شُعْبَتَانِ مِنْ شُعَبِ النِّفَاقِ. It's a fairly well-known hadith, but it needs a bit of unpacking. He says, obscenity and literally discourse are two of the branches of hypocrisy. Now it's clear why obscenity could be a sign of hypocrisy, because the believer is supposed to be outwardly dignified and refined and restrained, upright, muta'addib in his speech. But this bayan requires interpretation. And Imam Ghazali actually does something which he doesn't usually do in the Ihya, he leaves it to the commentaries, but here he's explaining what is this bayan, this kind of speech that is a branch of hypocrisy that's linked to obscenity. فيحتمل أن يراد بالبيان كشف ما لا يجوز كشفه. It may be that what's meant by speaking here is unveiling or revealing that which should not be revealed. In other words, speaking in such a way as to disclose the secrets of others, or to speak about things that are part of their private reality, or to mention their faults. All of that would constitute bayan in this hadith.
ويحتمل أيضا المبالغة في الإيضاح حتى ينتهي إلى حد التكلف.
Another meaning of bayan might be that it refers to excessive clarification to the extent that it becomes a form of ostentation. That's another of the branches of hypocrisy in the hadith.
ويحتمل أيضا البيان في أمور الدين وفي صفات الله تعالى.
And it's possible also that what the Prophet is referring to by saying that this is a, that there's a form of bayan which is from hypocrisy, is going into excessive expository detail in explaining theological and metaphysical matters. في صفات الله تعالى, in Allah's attributes.
فَإِنَّ إِلْقَاءَ ذَلِكَ مُجْمَلًا إِلَى أَسْمَاعِ الْعَوَامِ أَوْلَى مِنَ الْمُبَالَغَةِ فِي بَيَانِهِ.
And this is actually an important point, and Imam al-Ghazali comes to it again later on. He's saying it is better and preferable to speak in kind of generalizing terms about metaphysics when with ordinary people, rather than going to great lengths in detailing all of the subtleties of the questions of the names of Allah and their relationship to the divine essence.
إذ قد يثور من غاية البيان فيه شكوك ووساوس.
Because an extravagant or excessive theologizing in the presence of ordinary believers can actually lead to doubts and to wasawis, whisperings.
فإذا أجملت بادرت القلوب إلى القبول ولم تضطرب.
بادرت القلوب إلى القبول ولم تضطرب. But if you speak in general terms, the heart will very quickly accept what you say and will not be anxious or disturbed. So these are different interpretations of what's meant by bayan in this hadith.
ولكن ذكره مقرونا بالبداء يشبه أن يكون المراد به المجاهرة بما يستحي الإنسان من بيانه.
But he's saying, because in this hadith the neighboring word is bidha, obscenity, what's probably meant by the bayan here is to expose or to unveil or to reveal something, to speak publicly of something which human beings are normally modest about or shy of disclosing.
فإن الأولى في مثله الإغماض والتغافل دون الكشف والبيان.
Because what's preferable, what's more appropriate in such subjects is to keep them in obscurity and even to pretend to ignore them rather than unveiling them and to speak about them. And this is again part of the important Islamic virtue of haya. The hadith says, لِكُلِّ دِينٍ خُلُقْ وَخُلُقُ الْإِسْلَامِ الْحَيَاءِ. Every religion has a particular character trait which characterizes it, and the character trait of Islam is haya, modesty or bashfulness, humility. It's all of those things. Inshallah, we know what haya means. And this is part of the Muslim persona, and it applies to men as well as to women. So that كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أشد حياء من البكر في خدرها. In a hadith, the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had more حياء, more modesty than a virgin in her tent, which in the ancient Arabs is the symbol of shyness and modesty. And the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he met somebody's eyes, would always be the first one to lower his gaze. And this again is part of the modesty, the haya of the believer. And again, it's quite different from the Western model, which is to project yourself, to meet somebody in the eye, to grab their hand firmly, and to look at them. And it's actually polite to keep looking into somebody's eye in Western context. And if you look down, that's regarded as a sign of poor intention or of shiftiness. But for us, looking down, غض البصر, is something that is from the prophetic excellence, from the haya. And it's also to do with sitr, hiding, concealment.
إن الله ستير يحب الستر.
Allah is hidden and loves things to be hidden. Well, not everything, but obviously certain things. It's normal for human behavior to be protected, for there to be a private life. And this is part of the teaching of Hurma in Islam, that the Haram in Mecca, Medina, and Jerusalem are kind of private places, that the Kaaba has a veil, which is symbolically very significant, because there's certain magnificent realities that it is courteous to revere by means of creating a sitr or a barrier. That's symbolically very significant. And Hatkul Astar, literally tearing the curtains, that is to say, making public somebody else's secrets or private lives, is regarded as being one of the kaba'ir, one of the major sins. So this is, the Holy Prophet describes it as being khuluqul Islam, the character trait of Islam, that a modest demeanor, not projecting oneself and being a big, loud public personality, but being humble and valuing privacy, this is very important. And we see it, part of the prophetic excellence is that he had this hayat, which normally, stereotypically, we identify as a feminine virtue, modesty, traditionally associated more with the female temper than with the male temper. But it's associated in these hadiths with the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it is very characteristic of him that he was a man of futuwa, that is to say, of knightly martial virtue, the man of the sword, a great horseman, really a characteristically masculine figure. But at the same time, he has this quality of hayat, which is a sign of the spiritual excellence, because there's outward forms of masculinity, which are so often associated with machismo and ego, are in the prophetic vision turned into something completely different, and turned into a form of service and obedience rather than a means of vaunting oneself. And there's a lot more that could be said here, but it would probably take us too far afield, about Islamic conceptions of gender and what gender looks like if there's no ego involved, or at least one is trying to get rid of ego. And certainly traditional masculinity can only be understood in this prophetic sense. So this is what he's saying here, this bayan, which is a form of nifaq. In other words, if your nature is to disclose what really shouldn't be disclosed, people's sort of private secret things, then that is a sign of nifaq. And this again comes under the head of al-kalam al-madhmum, reprehensible speech. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله لا يحب الفاحش المتفحش السياح في الأسواق. Another hadith which indicates this quality of hayat. Truly Allah does not love the person who is obscene, who follows up on obscenity, and who speaks loudly or who shouts in the marketplace. And this is the image of the kind of barrow salesman who's yelling and who uses bad language, who is obscene, who perhaps is behaving inappropriately with female customers. That's the kind of rough person that is being denounced here. The Muslim is to be refined.
وقال جابر ابن سمرة كنت جالسا عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأبي أمامي. Jabir bin Samura, one of the great Sahaba, is saying, I was once with the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and my father was in front of me. فَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِنَّ الْفُحْشَ وَالتَّفَاحُشَ لَيْسَ مِنَ الْإِسْلَامِ فِي شَيْءٍ. He said, obscenity and human beings dealing with each other using obscene language has no place in Islam. وَإِنَّ أَحْسَنَ النَّاسِ إِسْلَامًا أَحَاسِنُهُمْ أَخْلَاقًا. And the best of people in Islam are those with the best character.
وَقَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ بْنُ مَيْسَرَةَ يُقَالُ يُؤْتَى بِالْفَاحِشِ الْمُتَفَحِّشِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ.
Ibrahim bin Maysara said, the person who is obscene and speaks obscenely will be brought on the Day of Judgment في صورتي كلب أو في جوف كلب, in the form of a dog or in the belly of a dog.
وقال الأحنف بن قيس ألا أخبركم بأدواء الداء. Shall I not tell you of the thing that بأدرى الداء, of the worst illness, اللسان البذي والخلق الدني, a foul tongue or a foul mouth, we say in English, والخلق الدني, and base character. فهذه مذمة الفحش. So here he ends this section and says this is the hadith material that condemns using obscene language. وَأَمَّا حَدُّ وَحَقِيقَتُ, as for its definition and its true nature. And it's a method of Ghazali's exposition in the Ihya that often the definition comes quite late in these chapters. Normally you'd expect it to be the other way around. And often in fiqh texts, that's what you get. You get definition of the terminology, and then the terminology is used. Imam Ghazali, who's absolutely a theologian of the revelation of Qur'an and hadith, tends to do something different in the Ihya. He gives you the Qur'anic quotes first, and then he gives you the hadith, sayings of the early Muslims, and then he gives you the definition. Why is that? Because you've already got a kind of definition in your mind, having seen the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam using these terms and seeing the terms used in the Qur'an. So then he can go on to present his definition. فهو التعبير عن الأمور المستقبحة بالعبارات الصريحة. It means expressing or giving voice to things that are considered ugly with explicit language. وأكثر ذلك يجري في ألفاظ الوقاع. And most of this, then as now, takes place in matters to do with the sexual act. وما يتعلق به, and things connected to it. So generally obscenity is connected with that. وقال ابن عباس إن الله حيي كريم. And Ibn Abbas said, truly Allah is حيي كريم. Allah is, we couldn't apply the word modesty to the divine, but it means the one who respects the principle of veiling and modesty, and is كريم here in the sense of noble. So this is part of a تخلق بأخلاق الله. If you restrain yourself from using inappropriate language in public, then your speech becomes noble, just as the divine speech is noble. And then he goes on to say that if people have to talk about those things, then they will use language like touching or صحبة, being with, كنايات عن الوقاع. These are expressions that people should be using. وَلَيْسَتْ بِفَاحِشَ, and these are not considered to be in this prohibited category. If you use those allusions, then it's not considered to be part of the sin of obscenity. And then he goes on to talk, it's quite an interesting kind of social comment really on the mores of his time. Obviously he was worried by this, the use of swearing and obscene language. وَهُنَاكَ عِبَارَاتٌ فَاحِشَةٌ يُسْتَقْبَحُ ذِكْرُهَا. He said there are many ugly expressions or obscene expressions which it would be ugly even to mention. وَيُسْتَعْمَلُ أَكْثَرُهَا فِي الشَّتْمِ وَالتَّعْيِيرِ. And mostly they are used as insults and as forms of condemning or criticizing others. وَهَذِهِ الْعِبَارَاتُ مُتَفَاوِتَةٌ فِي الْفَحْشِ. And these expressions are of different degrees of obscenity. وَبَعْضُهَا أَفْحَشُ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. Some of them are more obscene than others. وَرُبَّمَا اخْتَلَفَ ذَلِكَ بِعَادَةِ الْبِلَادِ. And this may well differ according to the customs of the country. So here it can't really be a fiqh issue, because the nature of an obscenity depends not so much on its intrinsicality, but on the effect that it has and the intention that's behind it. وَأَوَائِلُهَا مَكْرُوهَا وَأَوَاخِرُهَا مَحْزُورَ. He says, mild obscenity is disliked, and the utmost point of obscenity is forbidden. وَبَيْنَهُمَا دَرَجَاتٌ يَتَرَدَّدُ فِيهَا. And there are degrees between them.
And he says, this is not just about the marital act, بَلْ بِالْكِنَايَةِ بِقَضَاءِ الْحَاجَ عَنِ الْبَوْلِ وَالْغَائِطِ. And he says, similarly, it is preferable in other bodily functions not to speak frankly about relieving oneself, but to use some figure of speech, passing water rather than urination, for instance, or using a more frank and colloquial expression. He says, this is also important for those who are guarding their tongues. Do not speak frankly about those bodily functions, but use some kinaya, use some figure of speech.
فَإِنَّ هَذَا أَيْضًا مِمَّا يَخْفَى وَكُلُّمَا
And this is also, these are also activities that are hidden, and everything that is hidden is the due subject of modesty, of haya.
And then he also says something that to us seems a little bit dry, but is worth remembering.
وَكَذَلِكَ يُسْتَحْسَنُ فِي الْعَادَةِ الْكِنَايَةُ عَنِ النِّسَاءِ.
Similarly, when talking about one's women folk, one should use, he says, a figure of speech.
فَلَا يُقَالْ قَالَتْ زَوْجَتُكْ كَذَا.
One shouldn't say, your wife said this.
بَلْ يُقَالْ قِيلَ فِي الْحُجْرَةِ أَوْ مَنْ وَرَاءِ السِّتْرَةِ
أَوْ قَالَتْ أُمُّ الْأَوْلَادِ. Instead, it's better manners, he says, it's better, more refined to say, the mother of your children said this, or the one who is behind a screen said this, or the one who is at home said this.
فَالتَّلَطُّفُ فِي هَذِهِ الْأَلْفَاظِ مَحْمُودٌ.
He says it is best to be latif, or subtle, gentle, refined in using these expressions, and that's a praiseworthy thing. It's rude to somebody, rude to their family, to use, for instance, the name of somebody's wife. And this is, it's starting to fade now, but it is very important as a traditional Muslim sensibility that you just don't refer to the other people's family members, if they're female, by their first names. It's indiscreet. You use some kinaya.
And again, وَكَذَلِكَ مَنْ بِهِ عُيُوبٌ يُسْتَحْيَى مِنْهَا.
Similarly, the one should guard one's speech when referring to people who have defects or faults which are embarrassing.
فَلَا يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُعَبِّرَ عَنْهَا بِصَرِيحِ لَفْصِهَا.
It's not right that one should use a direct word when referring to them.
كَالْبَرَسِ وَالْقَرْعِ وَالْبَوَاسِيرِ.
Like, for instance, somebody who has leprosy or piles. Now, you know somebody has that, but you don't speak about that in public or to them.
بَلْ يُقَالَ الْعَارِضُ الَّذِي يَشْكُوهُ.
You say the state in which he's in, or his condition. We might say nowadays his medical condition.
وَمَا يَجْرِي مَجْرَاهُ.
And such like. Other such expressions are preferable.
فَالتَّصْرِيحُ بِذَلِكَ دَاخِلٌ فِي الْفُحْشِ.
Because to use frank language when referring to other people's defects is also considered to be loose speech, rough, it's obscene. So you don't just say to somebody, oh, you're a leper, aren't you? It's not appropriate. You find some other way of saying that, and this is part of the talatuf which the imam is referring to.
وَجَمِيعُ ذَلِكَ مِنْ أَفَاتِ لِسَانٍ.
And all of these things are included amongst the defects of the tongue.
Okay, then he goes on to psychologize, as he often does.
وَالْبَاعِثُ عَلَى الْفُحْشِ إِمَّا قَصْدُ الْإِذَاءِ وَإِمَّا الْإِعْتِيَادُ الْحَاصِلِ مِنْ مُخَالَطَةِ الْفُسَّاقِ.
So now he's saying, why is it that people use sort of rude and obscene language? Why do they use four-letter words? Why is this so widespread?
And he says the motive or the reason for obscenity is one of two things. Either a desire to hurt people, to upset them, or it's because people are used to such language because they've been keeping the wrong company. They've been with low people who use these words constantly, and therefore it's become normal for them.
قال أعرابي لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, a desert man, a nomad, a rough man from the hinterland, said to Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, أوصني, give me some advice.
فقال عليك بتقوى الله وإن امرؤ عيرك بشيء يعلمه فيك فلا تعيره بشيء تعلمه فيه.
So the Holy Prophet's response to this man is, you must have fear of Allah, and if somebody finds fault with you in something that he knows truly to be what you're like, in other words, somebody reproaches you or condemns you on the basis of a fault that you really possess, then do not reply by finding fault with him on the basis of something that you know in him. For instance, you might say, so-and-so insults you by saying, oh, you eat too much, and he's right. You must not reply, he's saying to the desert man, oh, but I know that you sleep too much or belch in public or whatever it might be. That's not the way. And this is, again, the Holy Prophet Ali knows the temper of the desert people, which is about feuding, vendetta, getting one's own back. And often in these wasaya, these counsels that he gives to the people of the desert, he's particularly concerned to break the cycle of feuding. You insult me, so I'm going to insult you, like little children on the playground. No, you have to break that. If he insults you, even if he's right, you don't get your own back by finding fault with him.
وَلَا تَسُبَّنَّ شَيْئًا. This is the last counsel that he gives. And do not insult anything.
قَالْ فَمَا سَبَبْتُ شَيْئًا بَعْدَهُ. And the Bedouin finally remarked, this might be years later, never again did I insult anything. And insulting things is something that the Imam is going to come on to discuss when he talks about cursing in a short while.
وَقَالَ عِيَاضْ إِبْنْ حِمَارْ ابن حمار قلت يا رسول الله إن الرجل من قومي يسبني وهو دوني هل علي من بأس أن هل علي من بأس أن أنتصر من.
So this guy Ayyad bin Hammar says, Ya Rasulallah, there's a man from my tribe who keeps insulting me, although he's from a lower social status. Is it wrong for me to get my own back on him?
فقال المتسابان شيطانان يتعاونان ويتهارجان يتعاويان.
And the Holy Prophet said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, two men who insult one another are two devils who bark and agitate one another.
وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم, this is a very famous hadith, this is Bukhari and Muslim, سباب المؤمن فسوق وقتاله كفر.
To insult a believer is a vice, corruption, and to slay him is disbelief. And on the basis of this hadith, many of the jurists will say that if you are known to be somebody who insults others, then your capacity for bearing witness in law cases is withdrawn, because it's fusuq. The Holy Prophet here is saying that it is a form of corruption.
وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم ملعون من سب والدي.
The Holy Prophet said صلى الله عليه وسلم, he who insults his parents is accursed.
وفي رواية, this is in Sahih Muslim, in the chapter in Sahih Muslim where he talks about al-mubiqat, the mortal sins, and which are the greatest of the mortal sins.
من أكبر الكبائر أن يسب الرجل والدي. One of the greatest of the mortal sins is for a man to insult his own parents.
قالوا يا رسول الله كيف يسب الرجل والدي.
And they said, O Messenger of Allah, how could a man ever insult his own parents?
قال يسب أبا الرجل فيسب الآخر أبا.
And he said, it takes place when you insult somebody else's parents, and they get their own back by insulting your parents. So you must never insult your own parents. Obviously, the context of this hadith is that people are staggered that anybody could ever do that. They obviously haven't watched the programs designed for teenagers on American television nowadays. But in this culture, the Sahaba were incredulous that anybody could ever insult their own parents. But what the Holy Prophet means is, don't insult somebody else's parents. In other words, don't say son of a donkey or daughter of a woman of easy virtue. And there's a lot of that in people's conversation. Yebna haram, son of what's haram. You're not to do that, lest your own parents be insulted in their turn. So that's the end of the Imam's treatment of the seventh of these defects of speech. And we now move on to number eight, which is related but more acute, which is alan, which is cursing. And this is more problematic because it brings in, if you like, the supernatural dimension. You're not just saying, I don't like the look of your face. It's like calling down Allah's damnation on somebody. It's a much graver matter. And again, the Imam is very concerned about this because he knows how widespread it is. People are always cursing each other. Taxi drivers in Cairo do it 100 times a day. It's very common. And this is the opposite of the way that the Imam is expounding. So, and we can also see, generally speaking, in this sequence of 20 vices that is moving from the least to the more serious and vicious. And there's some interesting stuff here because it's part of our akhlaq that we respect Allah's creation as something that isn't fallen but is in its own way, with its own lisan al-hal, with its own form of making tasbih of Allah perfect. And so the Imam here begins by talking about cursing things and cursing animals before he gets on to the still graver matter of cursing other human beings. أَمَّا لِحَيَوَانٍ أَوْ جَمَادٍ أَوْ إِنسَانٍ إِمَّا لِحَيَوَانٍ أَوْ جَمَادٍ أَوْ إِنسَانٍ وَكُلُّ ذَلِكَ مَذْمُومٍ. Cursing can be of an animal or of an inanimate object or of a human being. وَكُلُّ ذَلِكَ مَذْمُومٍ. And all of that is reprehensible. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المؤمن ليس بلعان. This is in Tirmidhi. The Holy Prophet says صلى الله عليه وسلم, the believer is not a cursor. وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تلعنوا بلعنة الله ولا بغضبه ولا بجهنم. Another hadith in Tirmidhi, the Holy Prophet ﷺ is telling us, do not curse one another with Allah's curse, and do not invoke His anger upon one another, and do not wish hellfire for them. So that would be saying something like, damn you, or go to hell, or may you rot in hell, or those expressions, very common in all cultures. The Holy Prophet is specifically telling us that this is wrong. So do not invoke Allah's curse upon somebody. Do not invoke His anger. Do not say, may Allah be angry with you. All of this is forbidden. وَقَالُوا حُذَيْفَ مَا تَلَاءَنَا قَوْمٌ قَطُّ إِلَّا حَقَّ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقَوْلِ. حُذَيْفَ, this is حُذَيْفَ ibn al-Yaman, one of the possessors of the esoteric mystical secrets bequeathed by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sahib sirr al-nabi, the possessor of the Prophet's secret, says here, never do a people curse each other but that their saying comes true. So if there's a community where people are always cursing each other, insulting each other, saying go to hell, using this obscene language, that will be their reality. وقال عمران بن حسين بينما رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في بعض أسفاره. عمران بن حسين said, when the Holy Prophet was on one of his journeys, إذ امرأة من الأنصار على ناقة لها. He saw a woman riding a camel that belonged to her. فضجرت منها. And the camel was misbehaving or was protesting against her while she was riding it. فلعنت her, and she cursed it. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, that they should remove, that she should get down from the camel and that her saddle should be removed from the camel, فَإِنَّهَا مَلْعُونَ, saying to the woman, the camel is cursed now, so surely you don't want to ride it.
فقال فكأني أنظر إلى تلك الناقة تمشي بين الناس لا يتعرض لها أحد.
And it is though I could still see the scenario. The camel was just walking about amongst people. Nobody wanted to touch it. The Holy Prophet was, as it were, calling her bluff. If it's really cursed, then you don't want to ride it. And people were frightened to touch it.
وقال أبو الدرداء ما لعن أحد الأرض إلا قالت لعنك الله.
Abu Darda said, never does anybody curse the ground or curse the earth, but that it calls down Allah's curses upon them in return. So we're not allowed to curse the land or to curse the earth.
وقال أنس كان رجل يسير مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على بعير.
A man was once traveling with Allah's messenger on a camel. فلعن بعيرا, and he cursed his camel.
فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم يا عبد الله لا تسر معنا على بعير ملعون.
O servant of Allah, don't travel with us if your camel is accursed.
وقال ذلك إنكار عليه.
And he said this was his way of criticizing the man.
And then we get the definition. وَاللَّعْنُ عِبَارَةٌ عَنِ الطَّرْدِ وَالْإِبْعَادِ مِنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى.
What is cursing? Cursing is a formula which indicates expulsion and distance from Allah. That's what لَعْن is. It's to invoke distance or to say that one is distant from Allah.
وَذَلِكَ غَيْرُ جَائِزْ إِلَّا عَلَى مَنِ اتَّصَفَ بِصِفَتِهِ
بِصِفَةٍ تُبْعِدُهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَهُوَ الْكُفْرُ وَالظُّلْمُ. So what he's doing now is to get into the situation of where it is permissible to curse somebody. You can't curse camels, you can't curse the earth, they're just Allah's creations. And the Holy Prophet ﷺ said the believer is not la'an, he's not a curser. But nonetheless, there can be a place for a curse. And this needs to be discussed with great care. And the Imam's treatment here is actually quite unusual and quite beautiful. So it is not permissible to indicate that somebody is far from Allah or that one wishes them to be far from Allah unless that person genuinely is qualified by an attribute which is indeed distancing them from Allah. And these are two things. Al-kufru wa-zulma. Disbelief and injustice. بأن يقول لعنة الله على الظالمين. For Allah himself says, may Allah's curse be upon the unjust, upon the tyrants. وعلى الكافرين, and upon those who deny his reality.
وينبغي أن يتبع فيه لفظ الشرع.
And in doing this, if one is cursing, one should follow the formulas that are given in the revelation itself.
فإن في اللعنة خطر.
Because there is a risk, there is a danger in cursing.
لأنه حكم على الله عز وجل بأنه قد أبعد الملعون.
Because it is a judgment that Allah has distanced that cursed person. In other words, it's not just an expression of a wish, it is a statement that that person is already far from Allah's mercy. And you really have to know that, otherwise you're taking a risk.
وَذَلِكَ غَيْبٌ لَا يَطَّلِعُ عَلَيْهِ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى.
And that person's distance from Allah is an unseen thing. Only Allah knows about it.
وَيَطَّلِعُ عَلَيْهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ.
And the Holy Prophet knows about it.
إِذْ أَطْلَعَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ.
Because Allah showed him certain things. So he's telling us to beware. Cursing is something that can be possible, but in certain very restricted circumstances. And he's saying, be aware that to curse is to declare that somebody is far from Allah, and really only Allah and his messenger know that for sure.
وَصِفَاتُ الْمُقْتَضِيَةُ لِلَّعْنِ ثَلَاثَةً.
The qualities which require cursing or which can lead to cursing are three.
Al-kufru wal-bid'atu wal-fisq.
Disbelief, heretical innovation, and corrupt behavior.
وللعن في كل واحدة ثلاث مراتب.
And cursing in each of these categories has three different degrees. There's three degrees of cursing.
اللعن بالوصف الأعم. Firstly, you can curse with a general description. كقولك لعنة الله على الكافرين.
May Allah curse those who reject him.
والمبتدعين والفسقة.
And the heretics and the people who are corrupt.
الثانية اللعن بأوصاف أخص منه.
And the second is to curse using more specific language, such as to say, may Allah curse الزنات والظلمة وآكل الربا. May Allah curse the adulterers and the tyrants and those who consume usury.
وكل ذلك جائز. And all of this is permissible. It is permissible to say, may Allah curse the adulterers or the fornicators.
جائز.
ولكن في لعن أوصاف المبتدعة خطر.
But you have to beware, he says, there's a risk in cursing specifically the innovators.
لأن معرفة البدعة غامضة.
Because it's a subtle matter to know what actually a bid'ah consists in.
وَلَمْ يَرِدْ فِيهِ لَفْصٌ مَأْثُورٌ.
And there is no specific formula in the Qur'an or the hadith for the cursing of a heretical innovator.
فَيَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُمْنَعَ مِنْهُ الْعَوَامِ.
So the ordinary people should be prevented from this form of cursing.
لِأَنَّ ذَلِكَ يَسْتَدْعِي الْمُعَارَضَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَيُثِيرُ نِزَاعًا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ.
Because if they were to curse people of the wrong theological position, this would bring about a reaction and a comparable curse from the other side and would stir up a dispute. So this is classic in our situation that we should not allow ordinary Muslims, which includes ourselves, to say, may Allah curse this group of the Shia or that group of the Ibadiyya or this group of the Ahmadiyya or whatever it might be, because this stirs up dissension and causes them to curse us in exchange and doesn't resolve the issues that are at stake.
And then he says, the third type of cursing, الثالثة, اللعن للشخص المعين,
is cursing a specific individual.
وهذا فيه خطر,
and this also is dangerous.
كقولك زيد لعنه الله وهو كافر أو فاسق أو مبتدع.
So in the case of, for instance, you're saying, may Allah curse Zayd, he is a kafir, or a fasiq, or an innovator.
والتفصيل فيه أن كل شخص ثبتت لعنته شرعا فتجوز لعنته.
The detail here, specifics, and he's narrowing this down more and more, is that every individual who is known to be accursed in the revelation, you may curse that individual.
كقولك فرعون لعنه الله.
So when you say فرعون, you can say لعنه الله.
وأبو جهل لعنه الله.
Why?
لأنه قد ثبت أن هؤلاء ماتوا على الكفر.
Because it's established that those people died in their corrupt, unbelieving state.
وعرف ذلك شرعا.
And that is known by revelation.
أما شخص بعينه في زماننا,
as for an individual, a named individual in our time,
كقولك زيد لعنه الله,
such as you might say زيد, may Allah curse him,
وهو يهودي مثلا,
and he is a Jew, for instance,
فهذا فيه خطر,
this he says is also dangerous,
فإنه ربما يسلم,
because he might become a Muslim.
فيموت مقربا عند الله,
and die in a state of great closeness to Allah.
فكيف يحكم بكونه ملعونا.
So how can you judge him to be accursed? This is all really important when you consider what goes on in Muslim internet chat rooms, people cursing each other, cursing the Jews, cursing the Christians, cursing individuals amongst them. Imam al-Ghazali is saying that's dangerous. You don't know how those people will end up. You don't know how you'll end up. And then he comes up with a counter argument. Obviously, this was a live dispute in his time.
فَإِنْ قُلْتَ يُلْعَنُ لِكَوْنِهِ كَافِرًا فِي الْحَالِ.
He's being cursed because he's a kafir right now.
كَمَا يُقَالُ لِلْمُسْلِمِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ.
Just as we might say to a Muslim, may Allah have mercy on him.
لِكَوْنِهِ مُسْلِمًا فِي الْحَالِ.
Because he's a Muslim right now.
وَإِنْ كَانَ يُتَصَوَّرُ أَنْ يَرْتَدْ.
Even though it's imaginable that he might end up not a Muslim.
فَعْلَمْ.
And this, again, is something, again, this is a live issue. You do hear it amongst Muslims. If somebody says, oh, may Allah curse Netanyahu, or whatever it might be, I'm just talking about his accursedness at the moment. Imam al-Ghazali is saying, no, you can't do that.
فَعْلَمْ أَنَّ مَعْنَى قَوْلِنَا رَحِمُهُ اللَّهُ أَنْ ثَبَّتَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ.
So he's replying by saying, when we say of somebody who's still alive, may Allah show him his mercy, what we mean is, may Allah strengthen him in Islam,
الَّذِي هُوَ سَبَبُ الرَّحْمَةِ,
which is the cause of mercy,
وَعَلَى الطَّاعَ,
and in obedience to him.
وَلَا يُمْكِنْ أَنْ يُقَالْ ثَبَّتَ اللَّهُ الْكَافِرَ عَلَى مَا هُوَ سَبَبُ اللَّعْنَةِ.
And it's not possible that we might say, may Allah keep somebody in the state which is the reason for the curse. So it's not a legitimate argument, he says.
فَإِنَّ هَذَا سُؤَالٌ لِلْكُفْرِ
وَهُوَ فِي نَفْسِهِ كُفْرٌ. Because if you did say, may Allah curse Netanyahu, in the kind of hope that he would forever be accursed, that's a form of approving of kufr for somebody, and that's haram.
فَفِي هَذَا كُلِّهِ خَطَرٌ.
In all of this there is a risk and a danger.
وَلَيْسَ فِي تَرْكِ اللَّعْنِ خَطَرٌ.
But there is no risk in simply not cursing somebody.
وَإِذَا عَرِفْتَ هَذَا فِي الْكَافِرِ.
And if you know that this applies even to the non-Muslim,
فَهُوَ فِي زَيْدٍ الْفَاسِقِ أَوْ زَيْدٍ الْمُبْتَدِعِ أَوْ لَا.
And it applies even more so to the Muslim who is corrupt, or the Muslim who is in a state of heretical innovation. It applies to him even more.
فَلَعْنُ الْأَعْيَانِ فِيهِ خَطَرٌ.
So to curse individuals is dangerous.
لِأَنَّ الْأَعْيَانَ تَتَقَلَّبُ فِي الْأَحْوَالِ.
Because individuals can change.
إِلَّا مَنْ أَعْلَمَ بِهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ.
Except people who are specified by the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
فَإِنَّهُ يَجُوزُ أَنْ يَعْلَمَ مَنْ يَمُوتُ عَلَى الْكُفْرِ.
Because the Holy Prophet knew certain individuals who would be dying in a state of kufr.
وَلِذَلِكَ عَيَّنَ قَوْمًا بِاللَّعْنِ.
And it is for this reason that he named individuals as accursed.
فَكَانَ يَقُولُ فِي دُعَائِهِ عَلَى قُرَيْشِ اللَّهُمَّ عَلَيْكَ بِأَبِي جَهْلِ إِبْنْ هِشَامِ وَعُتْبَ إِبْنْ رَبِيعَ.
So he used to say in his prayer, O Allah, take Quraysh, take Abu Jahl bin Hisham, and take Utba bin Rabi'a.
And then, وَذَكَرَ جَمَاعَةً قُتِلُوا عَلَى الْكُفْرِ بِبَدْرٍ حَتَّى أَنَّ مَنْ لَمْ يَعْلَمْ عَاقِبَتَهُ كَانَ يَلْعَنُ فَنَهَا عَنْ.
And then the Holy Prophet ﷺ mentioned a group who had been killed in a state of unbelief. These are the pagans who were fighting against the Muslims at the Battle of Badr, and nobody really knew what their final state would be, and the Holy Prophet forbade that they should be cursed.
إِذْ رُوِيَ أَنَّهُ كَانَ يَلْعَنُ الَّذِينَ قَتَلُوا أَصْحَابَ بِئْرَ مَعُونَ فِي قُنُوتِهِ شَهْرًا.
So what he's doing here, the Imam, is replying to those who are saying, well, we can curse the Mu'tazila, or we can curse the Shia, or we can curse X, Y, Z. He's working through the argument in order to demonstrate that you can't do that. The counter-argument is, well, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cursed Abu Jahl and cursed those of Quraysh. But that was exceptional because the Holy Prophet, through the light of prophecy, knew that those people would die in a state of unbelief. They were out of hope. So the next instance that it comes up is the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his Qunut du'a, for a month, cursed those who had assassinated his companions at the well of Ma'una. It's a famous ambush occurrence. And then,
فَنَزَلَ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ أو يتوب عليهم أو يعذبهم فإنهم ظالمون. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam cursed these killers for a whole month, and then the revelation came down and Allah said, you have nothing in the affair. Allah may relent towards them, or he may punish them, فَإِنَّهُمْ ظَالِمُونَ, because they are the unjust. يَعْنِي أَنَّهُمْ رُبَّمَا يُسْلِمُونَ. In other words, it may be that they will become Muslims. فَمِنْ أَيْنَ تَعْلَمُ أَنَّهُمْ مَلْعُونُونَ. So how is it that you can know that they are accursed? Yeah, there's some interesting episodes here. رُوِيَ أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ سَأَلَ أَبَا بَكْرٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ عَنْ قَبْرٍ مَرَّ بِهِ وَهُوَ يُرِيدُ الطَّائِفِ. The Holy Prophet asked Abu Bakr about a grave which he passed when he was on his way to Ta'if. فَقَالَ هَذَا قَبْرُ رَجُلٍ كَانَ عَاتِيًا عَلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. This is the grave of a man who was defiant against Allah and his messenger. And he was Sa'id ibn al-As. فَغَضِبَ إِبْنُهُ Amr ibn Sa'id. And his son, Amr ibn Sa'id, became angry. وَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ هَذَا قَبْرُ رَجُلٍ كَانَ أَطْعَمَ لِلطَّعَامِ وَأَضْرَبَ اللِّحَامِ مِنْ أَبِي قُحَافَةِ وَأَضْرَبُ لِلْحَامِ مِنْ أَبِي قُحَافَةِ. So the son of this man who had been an enemy of Islam, who is with the Holy Prophet and is a Muslim, is angry that his father should be criticized when he's in his grave. And the son says, yeah, O Messenger of Allah, this is the grave of a man who was more generous in giving food than Abu Quhafa. فَقَالَ أَبُو بَكَرْ يُكَلِّمُنِي هَذَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْكَلَامِ. And Abu Bakr said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, can this man speak to me in these terms? فَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ أُكْفُفُ عَنْ أَبِي بَكَرْ. فانصرف ثم أقبل على أبي بكر فقال يا أبا بكر إذا ذكرتم الكفار فعمموا. And then he said, oh Abu Bakr, if you mention the unbelievers, speak in generalities, speak in general terms. فإنكم إذا خصصتم غضب الأبناء للآباء فكف الناس عن ذلك. If you do condemn them, even though it's known, in this case it was known that the man was an enemy of Islam, he's saying do not criticize him by name as an individual, because if you do so, then their sons will become angry on their father's behalf. So again, is restricting still further the extent to which we can curse even people who are known to have died in a state of disbelief. And this also is important, and it is something to remember, for instance, when visiting non-Muslim graveyards, that a respect is called for, and certainly cursing is not called for. This is a long section, the section on cursing, because it is a perennial issue. Yeah, he talks a bit about the issue of the cursing of the killers of Imam al-Hussein. Yeah, and again he says, وَعَلَى الْجُمْلَةِ, in summary, فَفِي لَعْنِ الْأَشْخَاصِ خَطَرٌ, it's dangerous to curse individuals. فَلْيُجْتَنَبْ, let that be avoided. وَلَا خَطَرَ فِي السُّكُوتِ عَنْ لَعْنِ إِبْلِيسِ, even falling silent rather than cursing Iblis will do you no harm. So never mind cursing others. And it's a good point. You don't gain anything from cursing somebody. So if in doubt, don't do it. فَإِنْ قِيلْ هَلْ يَجُوزُ لَعْنُ يَزِيدِ, if it's said, is it permissible to curse Yazid? لِأَنَّهُ قَاتَلَ الْحُسَيْنِ, because he slew al-Hussein, أو آمر به, or commanded that he be killed. قلنا هذا لم يثبت أصلا, we would say, this has not been established or demonstrated at all. فلا يجوز, in other words, the
culpability of Yazid has not been established. That's the point he's making.
فَلَا يَجُوزُ أَنْ يُقَالْ إِنَّهُ قَتَلَهُ أَوْ أَمَرَ بِهِ.
It's not permissible even to say that Yazid killed al-Husayn, or that he commanded that al-Husayn be killed, which is indeed the case. Yazid was far away. The narratives differ. The battle took place on the spur of the moment. It's not established that he was responsible.
It's not. ولا إذ لا تجوز نسبة مسلم إلا كبيرة من غير تحقيق.
It's not permissible to attribute a mortal sin to a believer without proof.
نعم يجوز أن يقال قتل ابن ملجم عليا.
Yes, it's lawful to say Ibn Muljam killed Ali, because that's demonstrated and known.
وقتل أبو لؤلؤة عمر رضي الله عنهم,
and Abu Lu'lu'a killed Umar. You can say that.
فإن ذلك ثبت متواترا,
because that's been established through multiple narrations.
فلا يجوز أن يرمى مسلم بفسق أو كفر من غير تحقيق.
But you cannot, without having solid evidence, accuse any Muslim of corruption or disbelief.
قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Holy Prophet says, صلى الله عليه وسلم, this is a hadith in Bukhari, لا يرمي رجل رجلا بالكفر ولا يرميه بالفسق إلا ارتدت عليه إن لم يكن صاحبه كذلك.
So he's moving on to another issue here, which is accusing another believer of kufr. This is another form of reprehensible speech, a defect of the tongue. So in the hadith, the Holy Prophet says, let no man accuse another man of disbelief, and let him not accuse him of corruption or immorality. If he does, then if the one he is speaking of is not like that, then he will carry the sin that he has accused him of.
وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم ما شهد رجل على رجل بالكفر إلا باء به أحدهما.
Never does a man testify to another man's unbelief without one of them genuinely being an unbeliever.
إن لم يكن كافرا فقد كفر بتكفيره إياه.
If that man is not a kafir, then he himself has become an unbeliever by making takfir of him. And this is a number of these sound hadiths in which the Holy Prophet ﷺ makes it crystal clear how forbidden it is to accuse another Muslim of kufr. One always finds some way of making allowances even for the most outrageous behavior. And otherwise, the hadith itself is saying that we ourselves become mukaffar, we ourselves leave Islam as a result of having accused somebody else of disbelief. So again, this is of a piece with the rest of the Imam's discussion. He really doesn't like cursing, he doesn't like takfir. He's saying it's no skin off your nose if you just don't do it, just leave it alone.
وقال معاذ قال لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أنهاك أن تشتم مسلما أو تعصي إماما عادلا والتعرض للأموات أشد.
The Holy Prophet says صلى الله عليه وسلم, I forbid you from insulting any other Muslim, or disobeying a just ruler, or speaking ill of the dead, which is even worse. This again is part of the adab of the Muslim. You don't speak well of, you don't curse, you don't insult the dead.
قال مسروق دخلت على عائشة رضي الله عنها فقالت ما فعل فلان لعنه الله. قلت توفي. قالت رحمه الله. قلت وكيف هذا.
So Masruq said, I once visited Aisha radiallahu anha, and she said, what's so-and-so, such and such an accursed person doing? And I said, he's died. And she said, rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy on him. And I said, وكيف هذا? How can this be? First you're saying, لعنه الله, and then you say, رحمه الله. قالت, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, لا تسب الأموات. The Holy Prophet says, عليه الصلاة والسلام, do not speak ill of the dead. فإنهم قد أفضوا إلى ما قدموا. Because they've gone on to the works that they sent ahead of them. وقال عليه السلام لا تسب الأموات فتؤذوا به الأحياء. And he said, do not insult the dead, lest you harm thereby the living. وقال عليه السلام, and he said, O people, أيها الناس, احفظوني في أصحابي وإخواني وأصحاري. Respect me in my companions and in my brethren and in my descendants. ولا تسبوهم أيها الناس إذا مات الميت. And do not insult them, O people. إذا مات الميت فاذكروا منه خيرا. If somebody dies, say only good about him. فإن قيل, and if it's said, فهل يجوز أن يقال قاتل الحسين لعنه الله أو الآمر بقتله لعنه الله, and if it's said, is it permissible to say, may Allah curse the killer of al-Hussein or the one who ordered that he be killed? قلنا الصواب أن يقال قاتل الحسين إن مات قبل التوبة لعنه الله. Then the right thing to say, and the most that you can say, is if al-Hussein's murderer died before Tawbah, then may Allah curse him. لِأَنَّهُ يَحْتَمَلْ أَنْ يَمُوتْ بَعْدَ التَّوْبَةِ, because it's quite possible that he could die after Tawbah. فَإِنَّ وَحْشِيًا قَاتَلَ حَمْزَ عَمَّ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, because Wahshi, the Ethiopian slave, killed Hamza, the uncle of the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. قَتَلَهُ وَكَافِرٌ, he killed him when he was an unbeliever. ثُمَّ تَابَ عَنِ الْكُفْرِ, and then he repented from his kufr. وَالْقَتْلِ جَمِيعًا, he repented from his kufr and from his fighting altogether. وَلَا يَجُوزُ أَلْيُلْعَنْ, and it's not permissible to curse him. You can't curse Wahshi, even though he killed Hamza, because he repented. Similarly with Hind, you can't curse her because she repented and became a Muslima. وَالْقَتْلُ كَبِيرًا وَلَا تَنْتَهِي إِلَى رُتْبَةِ الْكُفْرِ. Yes, the murder was a mortal sin, but it doesn't reach the degree of unbelief. Yeah, and the last thing that he says in this long, and to my mind very important section, when he talks about cursing, is وَيَقْرُبُ مِنَ اللَّعْنِ الدُّعَاءُ عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ بِالشَّرِ. Similar to cursing is to pray for evil to befall somebody. The same applies to all of these. It applies to the people of fisq, it applies to the people of tyranny, it applies to the people of corruption and of bid'ah. So we can see, and maybe we can move on to the next section, which is quite short, inshallah. We will do that as well, just so that we pace ourselves correctly. You can see what the Imam is doing here. He's basically engaged in a kind of social polemic. His was a time in which there was a lot of informal cursing and bad language and obscenity amongst the ordinary people, and is explaining how that has to be ruled out. But there's also specific issues which are almost Sharia issues to do with what is a curse. It's not always wrong. God curses some people. The prophets, alayhim wasalam, sometimes curse people. But what is done is to narrow the field of legitimate cursing so that you can curse certain named individuals who are known to have died in the state of Kufr in the past. But even the idolaters who died at Badr, you're not allowed to curse them. And people who then took their shahada, you're not allowed to curse them. So it's actually very limited. So these contemporary khutbas where there's cursing upon cursing upon cursing strike me as being the exact violation of the Holy Prophet's commandment that إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنَ لَيْسَ بِطَعَانٍ وَلَا لَعَانٍ, the believer is not somebody who frequently insults or frequently curses This is a jahili practice, and is something that we have to avoid. And similarly, endless prayers for the misfortune of others. Ghazali says there's khatar, there's danger in this, and you won't lose anything if you don't make those prayers. So I know time is getting on, but let me just do the ninth of these, which is shorter. Moving to something very different from cursing, al-afatu tasi'a, the ninth defect of the tongue, is al-ghina wa shi'ar, singing and poetry. And as he'll explain in this section, there's good singing and there's bad singing, there's good poetry, there's bad poetry. وَقَدْ ذَكَرْنَا فِي كِتَابِ السَّمَاعِ مَا يُحَرَّمُ مِنَ الْغِنَاءِ. We've already mentioned in the book on dhikr and sama' the forms of singing that are forbidden. وَمَا يَحِلْ, and what is praiseworthy. And basically his conclusion is that you judge the performance by where it is leading people. If it is leading people to greater obedience to Allah, then it is recommended. If it is leading them on to commit sins, then that form of music and singing is forbidden. فَلَا نُعَيْدُ. So we won't repeat that treatment here. وَأَمَّا الشِّعَرْ, as for poetry, فَكَلَامٌ حَسَنُهُ حَسَنٌ وَقَبِيحُهُ قَبِيحٌ. It is a discourse, the good of which is good, and the ugly of which is ugly. إِلَّا أَنَّ تَجَرُّدَ لَهُ مَذْمُومٌ. But to devote oneself single-mindedly to it is reprehensible. In other words, somebody who's kind of a full-time poet. This is something that Imam al-Ghazali is saying is not right. You have to be part of the world as well. It shouldn't become a kind of obsession. وَعَلَى الْجُمْلَةِ فَإِنْشَادُ الشِّعْرِ وَنَظْمِهِ لَيْسَ بِحَرَامٍ. In general terms, to recite and to compose poetry is not forbidden. إِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ فِيهِ كَلَامٌ مُسْتَكْرَى. As long as there isn't some ugliness in the speech. قَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِنَّ مِنَ الشِّعْرِ لَحِكْمَةٌ. In the hadith, there is wisdom in poetry. نعم مقصود الشعر المدح والذم والتشبيب وقد يدخله الكذب. Yes, indeed, the purpose of poetry is to praise certain people or things, or to condemn certain people or things, and to use maybe amorous language. And it may well be that lying enters into it. وقد أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حسان بن ثابت الأنصاري. The Holy Prophet told his own poet, Hassan bin Thabit, بِهِجَاءِ الْكُفَّارِ, to write poetry against the kuffar, وَالتَّوَسُّعْ فِي الْمَدْحِ, and to praise the Prophet and his companions expansively. فَإِنَّهُ وَإِنْ كَانَ كَاذِبًا فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَلْتَحَقُ فِي التَّحْرِيمِ بِالْكَذِبِ. So even though this is a form of lying, in other words, some of this poetry which praises certain individuals or things to the skies using metaphors that are not strictly true could be described as lying, it still is not the kind of lying that is muharram, that is prohibited. And here he's entering into a debate on what we would nowadays call poetic license. That is to say, the poets, most of what they say is not literally true, but truthfulness is a high virtue, sidq, and telling lies is not quite right. So to say your lips are as a red ruby, well, not really. That's telling a lie, I guess. But in this context, this is not reprehensible lying. So he gives examples of poems now. كقول الشاعر وَلَوْ لَمْ يَكُنْ فِي كَفِّهِ غَيْرُ رُوحِهِ لَجَادَ بِهَا فَلْيَتَّقِ اللَّهَ سَائِلُهُ. Which means, it's talking about somebody's generosity. Had there been in his hands nothing except his own spirit, he would even have given his spirit. So let those who ask for things from him fear Allah. Now, Imam al-Ghazali says, فَإِنَّ هَذَا عِبَارَةٌ عَنِ الْوَصْفِ بِنِهَاةِ السَّخَاءِ. What this is a metaphor for the utmost of generosity. He doesn't have anything, but is so generous that he would even give you his spirit. That's not really true, literally, he's not in a position to do that. It's a metaphor for generosity.
فَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ صَاحِبُهُ سَخِيًّا كَانَ كَاذِبًا.
But if the person he's writing about was not generous, then this would be a lie.
وَإِنْ كَانَ سَخِيًّا فَالْمُبَالَغَةَ مِنْ صُنْعَةِ الشِّعْرِ.
And if he is indeed generous, then exaggeration, hyperbola, is part of the craft of poetry.
فَلَا يُقْصَدُ مِنْهُ أَنْ يُعْتَقَدَ صُورَتُهُ.
And what's intended in the poem is not that people should think that this is literally true.
وَقَدْ أُنْشِدَتْ أَبْيَاتٌ بَيْنَ يَدَيْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ
لَوْ تَتَبَّعْتَ لَوْ تُتُبِّعَتْ لَوُجِدَ فِيهَا مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ. And poems were recited in the presence of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which, if one looked at them carefully, one would find similar cases of lying or untruth in them.
فَلَمْ يَمْنَعْ مِنْ.
And he did not prevent the poets from doing this.
قَالَتْ عَائِشَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ.
Incidentally, there's a lot of stories of Aisha in the Ihya, which is interesting, and I'm not quite sure why. She's not always that salient in Sufi literature, but in the Ihya, she's really all over the place. One could write a very interesting book, I think, on the personality of Aisha as deployed by Imam al-Ghazali as a kind of sage. So, she's saying, radiallahu anha, kana rasulullahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yakhsifu na'lahu.
One day the Holy Prophet was mending his sandal.
وَكُنْتُ جَالِسَةً أَغْزِلْ. And I was sitting down, spinning.
فَنَظَرْتُ إِلَيْهِ.
And I looked at him.
فَجَعَلَ جَبِينُهُ يَعْرِقْ.
And his forehead started to sweat.
وَجَعَلَ عِرْقُهُ يَتَوَلَّدُ نُورًا.
And his sweat started to turn to light. So this is a kind of religious vision that she's having. It's a domestic scene. He's fixing his sandals. She's spinning. She looks at him and she sees this light coming from his blessed sweat. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
قَالَتْ فَهِبْتُ.
And she said, I was overawed, or I was afraid.
فَنَظَرَ إِلَيَّ.
And he looked at me.
فَقَالْ مَا لَكَ.
And he's مَالَكِ. And he said, what's wrong? What's wrong with you?
فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ.
And I said, O Messenger of Allah, I looked at you, نَظَرْتُ إِلَيْكَ.
فَجَعَلَ جَبِينُكَ يَعْرِقْ.
And your forehead started to sweat.
وَجَعَلَ عِرْقُكَ يَتَوَلَّدُ نُورًا.
And the drops of your sweat started to glow with light.
وَلَوْ رَآكَ أَبُو كَبِيرٍ الْهُذَلِ.
And if Abu Kabir al-Hudali was a famous rhetorician and a poet, if he saw you,
لَعَلِمَ أَنَّكَ أَحَقُّ بِشِعْرِهِ,
he would know that the poetry that he'd written would be more appropriate if applied to you.
قَالَ وَمَا يَقُولُ يَا عَائِشَ.
And he said, and what does he say, O Aisha? What is this Abu Kabir al-Hudali saying? Incidentally, Aisha is famous for her great knowledge of Arabic poetry. So here, she's obviously got a good quote in mind, and he's asking her, well, what does this Abu Kabir say?
قُلْتُ يَقُولُ هَذَيْنِ الْبَيْتَيْنِ ومبرأ من كل غير حيضة وفساد مرضعة ودائم غيلي وإذا نظرت إلى أسرتي إلى إسرة وجهه برقت كبرق العارد المتهلل.
Which means something like, if you looked at the entirety of his face, it would shine like the sudden lightning that gives praise.
قال فوضع صلى الله عليه وسلم ما كان بيده.
And the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم put what was in his hand down.
وقام إلي.
And stood and came to me.
وقبل بين عيني.
And kissed me between the eyes.
وقال جزاك الله خيرا.
May Allah reward you with good. يا عائشة.
ما سررت مني كسرور منك.
You were not as happy with me as I am happy with you. It's a kind of nice thing for lovers to say. And the chapter continues, but that's basically the point that the Imam wants to make about poetic license. It's important to make this exception. Generally, kadhib, exaggeration, extravagant metaphors and comparisons are not right. They can be deceptive. But in this specific context of poetry, it's lawful and even praiseworthy. And you can see how Aisha is really, really kind of in charge in this situation. She's the one who has the poetry, and she's the one who has the good, smart, elegant quote for the situation. And through this prophetic license, this allowing of the art of poetry, the hikmah that's in poetry, of course, we become the civilization that produces the greatest of all sacred literature, whether it be Ibn al-Farid or whether it be Jalaluddin Rumi, Fariduddin Attar. This is all from this wisdom which the Imam is here expounding, inshallah. So may Allah, inshallah, benefit us from these words and make us people of modest speech, people whose hearts keep away from obscenity, people whose hearts are not inclined to curse or insult others, people who always recognize the possibility that others may be saved, and people who are, inshallah, respectful of the arts of singing and of poetry, inshallah, where these are halal, because the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there could be within them hikmah, wisdom, inshallah. Barakallahu fikum, wa al-afu minkum, wa assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. So inshallah, in a few minutes we'll be putting out these Ghazali lectures. They have nice nasheeds and things in them, and inshallah you'll enjoy them. And all proceeds will go to the Cambridge New Mosque Project, inshallah. And we will be meeting, inshallah, for the dhikr at a 8:45 today, inshallah, rather than 9 o'clock, because people seem to be getting into it, so there's no reason why we shouldn't have an extra 15 minutes. So inshallah, 8:45 for our dhikr.